The minute they say this is like broadcast live, I start thinking of all the devilish things I can do.
Hi, guys.
We'll be right back.
Now you're the dreams of being taller.
Song you just played, you've gifted us tonight with this amazing set list that really kind of takes us all over your career. And 6'1", we just heard, that was from Exile in Guyville, and a lot of the attention when you first recorded Exile in Guyville and put it out was focused on the openness and the explicitness sometimes and the honesty of your lyrics. Did you have any sort of inkling when you were making the record that that would be the reaction?
I was living in Wicker Park in Chicago, and I would go to shows with the likes of like Steve Albini, so who put out a vinyl with some, I guess I can't say this kind of stuff, what can I say and what can I say? Very graphic, like the whole style back then was to be like super tough and super, and I just felt like the female perspective of that wasn't being seen. You know, there'd be like a token girl in a band, but that not that many voices were part of that indie rock scene. And so I thought I was going to impress like maybe, you know, a couple dozen people, and that was my aim. So all of a sudden, you know, my parents are gonna hear it. Like, if Matador, of course, you know, promoted it, and then I was living a persona I don't think I was even ready for. I don't think I'd even played on stage live when that record came out. So it was a steep learning curve.
What was it like to do that first, like, live thing? Like,
hideous.
Okay, I have to do this on stage.
I think Ira Glass once said that he had to look away. He's like, I think they're like when the skater falls a lot, you know, and you're just like, I can't watch it.
When your parents first saw it, what did they say?
Oh, well, they didn't see it for a while, but I wrote in my book, my horror stories book, a chapter where I was on that first tour, coming off that first tour, and I was in the bridal party of a friend of mine, and I had like these women at the country club coming up, spilling their whiskey, like, what's wrong with you? You have like a split personality, you know? So it was awkward. Awkward.
Did you find that, I mean, other than, you know, Ira Glass, which I never stop thinking about that now, Ira Glass or the country club ladies, did you ever find that you were pigeonholed by people's reaction to you after that record?
In a way, but I've done it to myself, so there was no, the horse is out of the barn, like, what are you going to do? It was a weird thing to become a persona. I think that's the way I look back on it now. Like, to have made this persona full of bravado and bravery when I was actually kind of shy, and I thought of it as art. I was an art history studio art major in college, so I thought of this as more like art. I never thought I would actually have a career in music. And then all of a sudden you have this great career, and you just, I mean, I'm so grateful to it now. I mean, it's changed me profoundly.
It's kind
for
of
the better.
It's like having an art concept, and then you're like, I have to live this.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yes. I wrote myself a character, and then she was with me forever.
I'm talking to Liz Phair on World Cafe. I'm Marina Duras. You have done a lot of changing. You've been a bit of a sonic shapeshifter throughout your career. We're going to get into that in a little bit, but right now you're about to head out on tour and release a new album called Soberish, and you reunite on this new album with Brad Wood, who produced Exile and Bagel. You've worked with him a bunch. How did that reunion come about?
Well, it was interesting. Matador put out a box set, a very comprehensive box set, filled with my very early cassette tape recordings called Girly Sound, which sort of prefigured Bagel in a lot of senses. I rewrote a bunch of those songs, and I used some of them on that album. And so this was just a wonderful moment in time where I felt like the culture was open and receptive to me again, and this box set, it brought me back to the past. I started thinking about those old days and thinking about Brad and the music that we made and the way that we worked in particular. He really listens to me and he lets me, you know, produce with him and do all my crazy things I want to do. So that's sort of the impetus, and it was so fruitful. I'm very, very proud of this new record.
I really
can't wait for you to hear it. I'm begging my management to put it out.
That when you said the culture is ready for you again. What does that mean?
Well, the Me Too moment, I felt like I'd been Me Tooing for a while, and it felt like it was just natural as time moved on. The world in which I wanted to live back in 1993, where there would be a ton of different women working in music and they would all have different styles, like, that's what the younger generation of artists, I feel, is like. They're completely unique, and they're the authors of their own vision. And it was like, it's like, in the beginning, I felt like I was one of the only people speaking my language in the midst of a foreign land. And now I feel like there's a huge nation of us. It's very exciting for me. I'm thrilled.
Of social media, which I didn't really have the heft that it has now, as it did even when you released your last full-length album. Can you imagine being the Liz Phair of the 90s with social media existing? And what that would be like.
No. I mean, it's hard enough for me. I sort of generally use one portal, and then management has to disseminate it through all the other, like, social media. It's hard. I'm from another generation. You know, we still made albums in long form that had to be if I could have imagined this world, I mean, if I knew back then what I know now, I've quickly learned to use a programmed keyboard while playing guitar. That would have been a smart move. I didn't figure that out in time. But yeah, I mean, the fact that I started with bedroom pop and recording on a 4-track, and now everybody records at home, it's like, I feel like more than anything, I raised my hand. Like, I was an early bedroom pop person. I was.
So your new album is coming out, it's called Soberish. You recently announced that title. Was it a day, 2 days ago that that actually came out?
Yeah.
I mean, by the time this airs,
I think it was yesterday.
Yeah, I think it was. I've lost track. Ballet has a way of erasing your sense of time. But yeah, so it just came out. I was wondering, you know, usually I don't ask people, oh, what's this album title mean? But I'm curious. Soberish. What's that about?
What does it mean? I strive to live a sober life, but in the last 4 years of our political climate, I can't manage it. So. Yeah! I've come to peace with Soberish. That's what I was doing today.
This is
Woke Cafe.
I'm Rena Turles talking to Liz Phair. You're going to play the first single from your new album, Good Side. Could you tell us about Good Side a bit before you play it?
Give me a prompt. I love the song. It's a very kind of, it's a chill way to end a relationship. It's a mature way to end a relationship. Like, let's cut it off now before we do harm to each other. Like, do no harm. So it's that kind of thing. It's a love song for the modern age.
Oh,
Of myself. I take Liz Phair, I put her on a hanger, kind of like Mr. Rogers, and I put her away in a closet. I'm not Liz Phair anymore. I become the observer rather than the observed. I found this really interesting, like the idea of Liz Phair as this malleable thing. I was wondering, what does that mean to you? I become the observer rather than the observed.
Well, it's the artist versus the extroverted performer. I think I lead a very dual life, and I think that's hard for people when they meet me in person. They're kind of expecting something different. I have terrible trouble dating, because if I meet a guy and I'm Liz Phair, he wants Liz Phair, and then I'm like, you want to stay at home? You know? But if they meet me and I'm my normal self, then Liz Phair is really shocking and really like, they're like, when they see me on stage. And it happened because of what we were talking about. I did not expect to be a rock star. And like, that sounds like, oh, I did not expect to be a rock star, but I really didn't. I was an artist my whole life. So to make the art that I want to make, I have to observe people and walk among people and just be completely normal. Otherwise I can't imagine. I don't know how people do it. I think that's why it's so hard for people when they're a performer 24/7.
Yeah, I think in your book, Horror Stories, your new memoir, there are some examples of when people do not respect the boundary of like when you are a person versus when you are there to be like observed. There's one chapter where you talk about your experience delivering your son, which I know you've talked about this before, but when I read it, I was in disbelief. You're in labor for hours, and someone at one point who works at the hospital,
the anesthesiologist,
asks for your autograph.
He's literally, we're okay, so just so you know, I had a 32-hour labor. So I was like, thank you. He turned out great. But, you know, at that point, when it gets really serious and they're like, we gotta get this kid out, and like, it goes from being a nice room to like, everything comes out of the ceiling, all these tools and lights and people come in, and they're waiting for the anesthesiologist, and I am eagerly anticipating his arrival as well, because at that point I'm like, I don't want to feel a thing. Like, so he's right on my right talking to me. He's talking about the Vic show that I played like a couple years ago. And he's asking me if I still play the Fender, you know, and I'm like, he's like, yeah, can I get your autograph if I leave it by the nursing station? Do you think you can sign it? And we are seriously like 15 to 20 minutes away from actual delivery. So like, it was just very surreal. I think of it as funny. Like, I didn't end up hating the guy. I actually thought he was sort of the rock star that we were all waiting for, so I thought it was all a very kind of interesting thing. But yeah, that shit happens.
There's part of me that almost has to, like, admire his guts.
Right!
To think of that point.
Right, he's just like, yeah, he's just there for it.
Did you end up giving him the autograph?
I'm sure I did. I'm absolutely positive I did.
I speak to Liz Phair, it's World Cafe, I'm Brandon Duras. There's another chapter in your memoir, Horror Stories, It's a chapter about a magazine photo shoot that you've done. Actually, there's a couple that you mentioned in there. One, where you're bound and gagged, which is supposed to sort of symbolize an outspoken woman who's being silenced. And another one that you talk about in the same chapter, where you're wearing only overalls and being photographed in the middle of a party. And you said this thing that's really stuck with me since I read it. And it talks about the first one, where you're bound and gagged, which might look really risque to people. And it might look for lack of a better word, not feminist. You say only a woman could have done this photo. Only a woman could have taken this photo. And you talk about looks, and you talk about like what are looks. I mean, when you talk about that idea of being observing, I guess I just want to ask you about that difference that you've experienced as an artist working with, like, when did you realize that you had the power to say no to things that you didn't want to do?
Ooh, that took a long time. I had not grown up wanting to be on stage. I had not thought about what the career would entail. I didn't know what was, as I say in the book, I didn't know what was normal for my profession. And I didn't have management. It all happened very suddenly. And it was, when did I first know how to say no? I went through a tough time. What everyone was lauding me, I was actually pretty miserable and felt pretty vulnerable. And I remember Kristen Stewart talking about that, and everyone was, you know, making fun of her for saying that she felt so violated by the cameras. But I related pretty heavily. Like, you don't know what's going on. And like that photo shoot, I was 26. I'd never done anything like this. I was half naked, and they were throwing a party around me, like to sort of watch this thing happen in front of them. And I think they just expected me to be like a crazy drinking rock star. And I ended up like going inward and just kind of lying there. And I say in the book, it was like bad sex. Like, you know, like no one knows what to do about it. It's just, you have to kind of keep going, but it's just awkward and awful. And it took me a long, long time. I know when. Here's when. I put out Whip Smart, my second record, and then I told my label I wasn't gonna tour. And I meant it. I went and got married, and I just said, you know what, no, I'm not interested in that, thank you very much. And I got a very strongly worded letter from their attorneys that told me that indeed I was gonna tour. And that was the tour that I went out by myself solo. It was my first solo acoustic tour. And it's one of the things I'm most proud of, and occasionally, like when I open for the Smashing Pumpkins solo, it is terrifying. It is as terrifying as you can imagine it to be, and it was for me too. I don't have some special DNA that makes it better. But I ended up finding my own voice. It was almost like an obstinate move. I'm like, fine, if you make me go out on the road, I will just be me. I won't give you like the bells and the whistles and all that kind of stuff. And it backfired on me because I thought they would then not want me to tour more, but I actually got better. I actually got a lot better. And then, it worked out. Yeah.
This is World Cafe. I'm Raina Duras speaking to Liz Phair. The next songs that you're going to perform for us are from your 2003 self-titled album. It was your fourth record, marked kind of a departure from the bluntly confessional style you were known for at the time. Would you be able to describe for us, even before you play it, the sound of your self-titled album?
Well, it's a bit of a misnomer because the way the fans experience it, it seems like a cohesive package, but it actually, that album comprises at least three, if not four, very separate recording situations. And a big change in my professional life because Matador, which was this indie label that I was on, all the indie labels were attaching themselves to majors at that point, or majors were buying up all the indie to make them not a threat. And they attached themselves to Capitol, but then they left. And I was the collateral. I was the only artist that was retained by Capitol, so all of a sudden I had like a whole new company to work with that I'd never chosen to sign with. And they were interested in hits. It was like the big 2000s, and it was like sink or swim, so I swam, and I got a lot of flack for it. It was very hard, but again, here's the silver lining that always shows up. You know, it was a very pop-oriented record. Like, I worked with the people that worked on Avril Lavigne's The Matrix, who are very cool people. I actually knew them from around LA. And so when I opened the door to see who these big hit makers were, I was like, Lauren? It was great. I had a lot of fun doing it. And as much as I was overwhelmed and didn't want to enter in this pop world, didn't understand what was going on, again, I learned how to perform for big audiences and for radio, and I learned so much. So meanwhile, the critics are like slaying me left and right. I'm doing therapy on the phone calls. On the bus, I remember I do like 8 phoners in a row. Phoners are like live interviews on radio. And people were so mad at me that I'd have to like explain to them that it's just music and it's okay and you don't have to listen to it. And like I would be like the mom of these people that were so betrayed. But concurrently, I'm becoming a much better performer and I'm being tested on the road, and for which I had experiences because of that popness of that record that I could never have had. And I'm incredibly grateful for it. Everything that's really hard ends up growing you in ways that you would never have challenged yourself if you were not there.
That's kind of funny, how there is almost like a double standard. You know, if someone was known as a pop star, decided to really write this like confessional, personal kind of album, I wonder if the backlash would be as intense as it was for somebody who is writing confessional, personal music, and then does a pop record. Like, why do you think people reacted like that?
I think it's because at that point, and luckily it's no longer this way, there was a very big divide between indie and major. There was a commercial war going on. And I had been emblematic of how you can be very successful without kowtowing to a major. But keep in mind, I've never signed to a major in my life. Like, that was not my doing. That was something that happened to me, and then I adapted. And I don't even mind, like, when people want me to be all indie again. I was never indie before Guyville. I found myself in Wicker Park and I was writing these songs. What is me is this and this. This guitar and me, that's the only thing that is actually true about me. And then everything else is what, you know, what outfit do you want to wear? What are you interested in? And I'm so glad now that people can do different genres and experiment without being hemmed in by their brand. I think that's really helpful for an artist, and I never understood why people freaked out so much about it. I mean, it's art. It should be wild and unexpected. It should be surprising. Why are we making names in the 1-3 space we have left? I don't get that.
Do you ever wonder if being a woman sometimes people have a harder time to accept, or being a woman sometimes people have a harder time accepting that you could contain multitudes? That you might have other aspects to your personality. Did you ever feel like that was part of it?
I personally didn't take it as a gender thing, but I can remember very distinctly being at VH1 one time in this sort of furor about like, oh, she's gone pop. And there were cameramen and, you know, people holding the mics, the booms, there are people standing around from the office, and I was doing an interview, and the interviewer said, like, do you think that this is, you know, because of sexism? And I was like, I don't really know. Do you guys think it was? And like the whole room was like. And that's sort of when I started to really, I'm a crazy little Muppet in my head. So sometimes I don't think in terms of, you know, like, I know when people are being assholes. I know when I'm being treated badly, but I think it was, but I'm not the best person to speak on that. You know, I'm in there slugging it out. I'm the ground troops.
Yeah, you're not the person who's treating you like that.
Right. Else is. Right. I was still worried that people were going to be like, she can't sing, she can't play. That was my entire concern. You know, like, I'm a great art maker, but I, as my mother says, if there's something that I'm unqualified to do, you can believe that I will do that next. So I really enjoy not knowing how to do something and then, like, throwing myself into it. So I was worried about something else entirely.
Well, Well, in a way, your next song, it kind of seems like a song where you celebrate having all of those different multitudes. Could you talk about extraordinary?
Extraordinary. I think that was a that was a sense of being a small female in a big male world and wanting to, I guess, strike at stereotypes and what do they call it now today? Self-care, like believe in yourself. It's that kind of anthem.
All right, this is extraordinary. This Phair. Oh, World Cafe.
Thank you.
in LA. I'm Raina Duras. This is World Cafe, and I'm speaking to Liz Phair. Liz, you started back in the early 90s in your bedroom, recording music, making tapes, the girly sound tapes that eventually led to everything else. And you were in your early 20s when you were making those tapes. When you look back on it now, if you could talk to that like 20-year-old version of you, what would you say to her?
The first thing that popped in my head was run. No. What would I say? I couldn't have wanted it to turn out any other way. I'm trying to think what I would have said. I think I didn't say, that's kind of what I'm known for, but I did and said everything that I wanted to do and say. And that has been, like, honestly, I was a polarizing artist in the beginning, and I think that's because of that. I think I did not, I just had enough. I just wasn't gonna be anything other than myself at that point. And so what would I say to her? I'd say you're in for a hell of a ride, I guess. I don't have advice for her. I would just, you know, because everything that sucked about it ended up turning me into a better and stronger person. I really couldn't. I hate when people say that too. They're like, I have no regrets. I have a ton of regrets, but the trajectory of my life was a very interesting path. I feel really lucky. I feel like I've done a lot and seen a lot, and I could have hidden in my room and been like this, you know, I wanted to be Daphne, but I probably was Velma, and I got to be Daphne, and that was cool.